Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rich Cooper with Space Foundation, and I drew the short straw to get the toughest crowd of the week. It is a pleasure to have you all here for this week, but tonight we get to celebrate three new technologies and some fabulous companies that have done some really amazing work. This is part of our Space Technology Hall of Fame. And in the partnership that we have had with NASA, it has been an ability for us to be able to herald the work that not only that NASA and other space agencies have done, but the work that industry and other researchers have done. But it is my challenge. It is my challenge tonight, along with some friends that I have in the audience, to keep your attention. So I want to let all the rowdy tables know I've got a number of flags up here. I got retired flags up here. I got a great core of senior enlisted leaders sitting up here. And some CEOs. And for those of you who don't behave, remember, they sign off on performance reviews and bonuses. So now that I have your attention, here's our plan. We're gonna have some fun. We're gonna learn about some really cool stuff that makes a difference to everyone in this room and on the planet. And we're going to celebrate some people and organizations that deserve their moment in the spotlight. Maybe we'll have a little bit more fun. But maybe we're all going to leave here more inspired by the people, messages, and networks that you've encountered this week, because the Hall of Fame is a culmination of many of those achievements. So on behalf of our Space Foundation team, who have worked tirelessly these past months, we hope you've had a fabulous Space Symposium week. It takes a team of teams to do this effort. So the first folks I want to give a shout out to and acknowledge is the more than 300 volunteers that worked with the Space Foundation team to make this week happen. Second, I want to acknowledge the amazing Broadmoor staff and management who, as always, have taken great care of us this week. You are all five stars and more. Thank you. Finally, I want to extend thanks to all of you for what you do in this industry to support what we at Space Foundation do and what the Space Technology Hall of Fame is all about. For nearly 40 years, the Space Foundation Hall of Fame has been showcasing how we have space-driven innovation excellence that benefits life on Earth. So tonight, while we induct those three technologies and those organizations into the hall, which again showcases the drive, imagination, engineering, and courage to make the once unimaginable into realities that make a difference. So at Space Foundation, we have a phrase. We have a lot of phrases. Some we can't say in public. But at Space Foundation, we have one key phrase. No one goes to space alone. It takes a team working together to make mission success. And that is as true in orbit as it is on the ground. And it's especially true when it comes to exploration. Exploration is many things to many different people, but in reality, it's an extended reach into the unknown. But that reach is only beneficial and balanced if we share it with others. Sharing is by its own action a great and often incalculable reward, because sharing has no end. Those are qualities that make up each and every inductee in the Space Technology Hall of Fame. Each and every one of them was used as part of exploration, and that discovery not only opened a door to the once unknown, but it brought rewards back to Earth where it could benefit everyone. There are many rewards that exploration offers, but bringing value and positive difference to others is a category unto itself. And tonight you're going to learn about three more of those pioneering explorers. That's the spirit of the partnership that Space Foundation has with NASA, with the Space Technology Hall of Fame. Together we look for technologies and the people and the organizations that create them to bring value and positive difference. One of those people is part of the NASA team and is our keynote speaker this evening. She too is a pioneer. She's an engineer by training, She's a leader of vision and heart, charged with guiding a workforce of 11,000 strong that support the International Space Station, commercial space flights, mission control, science programs, human spaceflight, and soon-to-be missions to the moon. And she does even more beyond that, outside of the facility that she leads, to inspire others to join her in the biggest pursuits any of us can take on. She's another space pioneering South Carolinian who is writing some big chapters of her own in our space pursuits, and she likes really cool walkout music. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Vanessa Weiss, Director of NASA's Johnson Space Center.
Fly me to the moon, let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words...
Good evening. I'm honored to be here tonight to celebrate an exciting week full of insightful discussions and to honor and recognize those developing technology for space exploration and for the benefit of humanity. And as the last keynote speaker for this 38th Space Symposium, I'm thrilled that I've been allotted one full hour to speak with you. I'm just kidding. I promise to keep my remarks brief. At NASA's Johnson Space Center, I am privileged to lead 11,000 employees who work each day to dare, unite, and explore space for all. Johnson Space Center is home to NASA's astronauts, mission control, and leads management and operations of the International Space Station and a host of NASA programs. Across the history of human space exploration, NASA's first six decades of discovery has benefited our lives in many ways. The benefits are making an impact worldwide in better health and medicine, transportation, public safety, consumer products, computer technology, environmental and agricultural resources, and industrial activity. Technology transfer also has a huge economic impact. It's creating businesses and jobs committed to bringing NASA-derived technology and products originated from space exploration into our cities and homes. As NASA prepares to send humans farther into the solar system than ever before, the missions of today, from conducting science and technology research on ISS that has supported humans living in space for over 22 years continuously, and our role in commercialization of LEO, to our plans for return of humans to the moon and working with commercial partners to establish a sustainable lunar economy. This ambitious path of exploration requires new technologies and international collaboration for global innovation to ensure our astronauts can safely and effectively conduct groundbreaking research today aboard the International Space Station, using the station as a testing ground for our future Artemis missions to the moon and then at Mars. Many of those technologies developed to send our explorers deep into space for longer periods of time will be new technologies and sustainable solutions for present issues here on Earth. For instance, long-duration space explorers will need fresh food, clean air, and a reliable water source, whether during an extended stay on the moon or to a 2 to 3 year round trip to Mars. The same is true for people on Earth, where climate change and population growth already cause food insecurities for many communities. Aboard the International Space Station, NASA is advancing technologies that purify air and water to keep astronauts safe and reduce the number of supplies that need to be delivered aboard our cargo resupply ships. Our environmental control and life support systems, or what we call ECLIS, for water recycling has been operating on the International Space Station since 2008. ECLIS reclaims water recycling and purification rates of more than 90%, including condensate from air, sweat, and urine. Air purifying technologies aboard the space station scrub these impurities from the air and even break down harmful gaseous components into beneficial elements like oxygen. And we're testing technologies that could provide the air and water recycling levels needed for deep space exploration. This technology has been adapted on Earth to aid in remote locations or places devastated by natural disaster that do not have access to clean drinking water. Under NASA's Moon to Mars program, plans are to build a sustainable presence to the moon and learn to live on another body before venturing further into the solar system. On April 3rd, we announced the first four astronauts who will venture on a flyby of the moon on Artemis II mission. NASA astronauts, yes. NASA astronauts, Commander Reed Wiseman, Pilot Victor Gover, Mission Specialist Christina Hammett-Cook, and Canadian Space Agency astronaut Mission Specialist Jeremy Hansen. They will be the first humans that will go to the vicinity of the moon in over 50 years. Yes, the crew, they will travel aboard NASA's Orion spacecraft during a 10-day mission to test and stress the Orion spacecraft's life support systems and to prove the capabilities and the techniques required to live and work in deep space in ways only humans can do. Then, building on the legacy from the Apollo program, Artemis is now going to take us to the moon and beyond in new ways. While the Orion spacecraft and the Apollo capsule may look alike, they are very different. Compared to Apollo's single computer that was on board, Orion has four redundant flight computers. And those computers will allow us to have the capability to send the Orion spacecraft further and for us to do more computations than we were able to do by the fact of 128,000 times more memory and 20,000 times faster than the Apollo computer. The Apollo program was a true marvel, and it advanced our scientific knowledge. And based on NASA's Apollo experience, tonight's JSC Space Technology Hall of Fame recipient, NASGRO, saw it was clear that a systematic analytical approach was needed to ensure structural integrity and damage tolerance of a spacecraft, especially for reusable vehicles like the space shuttle. The precursor to NASGRO was a computer program that simulates the repeated loading and unloading of components during launch, orbit, and landing to determine their ability to withstand manufacturing-induced, handling-induced, and surface-induced cracks. NASGRO is used on every human-rated spaceflight program at NASA and at ESA, as well as high-value robotic systems such as the James Webb Space Telescope. I'd like to take a moment to extend my congratulations to JSC team members Yakum Beek, Mohammed Zenginaya, and from our Jacobs contract team, Randy Christian, Michael Baldorf, Jan Goyal, and Shaq Yizmonov. With special contributions from Royce Former, he was a retired NASA technical monitor for the project, and Shiva Shavakurma, who's also a retired Jacobs team lead. And from Southwest Research Institute team leads, Craig McClung and Joe Cardinal. Congratulations. I'd also like to give congratulations to all of tonight's recipients. Nature's Fine. They discovered the protein-rich microbe phi in a geothermal spring in Yellowstone National Park. NASA sent a sample of phi to the International Space Station in July 2022, where it was discovered that the microbe could indeed be grown in microgravity. And the CINCOM program, the first mission to develop and implement geostationary satellites and completely revolutionize the world of satellite communication. You all have conducted fascinating work. Under our Moon to Mars program, we'll be conducting both robotic and human missions, allowing us to capitalize on these technologies and many more for scientific discovery. Together, let's keep pushing the boundaries of what we thought was possible and continue to inspire the Artemis generation of scientists, engineers, and explorers. With innovation, collaboration with academia, industry, and our international partners, and determination, the future is bright. Not just for space, but also life on Earth. As we prepare for Mars, the ability to build parts, habitats, and other materials in space is critical. NASA has been successfully printing parts on the International Space Station and has now turned some of those efforts to manufacturing on the moon. Housed at NASA's Johnson Space Center, NASA, using ICON's next-generation Vulcan construction system, constructed a 3D-printed habitat, our Mars Dune Alpha Habitat. It's called CHIPEA, Crew Health and Performance Exploration Analog. It's a series of analog missions that will simulate year-long stays on the surface of Mars. Each mission will consist of 4 crew members living in Mars Dune Alpha, resembling the expected experience for those living in future Mars surface habitats. The analog mission will provide valuable insights and information to assess NASA's food system, as well as physical and behavioral health and performance outcomes for future space missions. This is an advance in construction technology for the moon and Mars, but the technologies and processes can also be used to create sustainable housing solutions here on Earth. I want to congratulate again the recipients of the awards and thank everyone assembled for this very impactful space symposium. We can all look forward to a future that is not only full of discoveries, but one where the benefits of space exploration will positively impact our lives on Earth for generations to come. Thank you.
Throughout the world, throngs of people hailed the end of the war in Europe. President Truman announced the official surrender.
This is a solemn but glorious hour.
In a symbolic gesture, American troops destroy the Nazi Party emblem.
October 1945. World War II is over, and it's a new world. It's the dawn of the atomic age. the space age. Science is evolving rapidly, and scientists are doing their best to keep up. One RAF radar officer with a penchant for far-out thinking and writing envisions a system of man-made satellites in outer space that would enable global communications. Never mind that there were no such satellites, nor rockets big enough to launch them, nor radio equipment to connect with them. But this man dreamed big. His vision would position relay satellites far above the Earth's equator, where their orbit speed precisely matched the rotational speed of the planet and appeared motionless overhead in what's called a geostationary orbit. With only three satellites positioned just so, ground stations all over the planet could be linked together with light-speed signals relayed from 22,237 miles above. It took a few years for fiction to become fact, but it did, and our space visionary, one Arthur C. Clarke, would go on to dream up more ideas, encourage far-out thinking, and help popularize the idea that science was cool, and scientists were even cooler. After the launch of Sputnik in 1957, the race is on to explore and exploit this high ground of space. Early on, all communication satellites were low Earth orbit satellites, always in motion across the sky. Ground stations needed swiveling antennas and expensive tracking computers to keep up and maintain contact. NASA, DoD, and the fledgling space industry all recognize the imperative and promise of geostationary SATCOM. AT&T, TRW, and RCA work on advanced designs, and NASA Goddard Space Flight Center contracts with Hughes Aircraft Company to create a new generation of SATCOM systems. The group at Hughes, led by Harold Rosen and team members Donald D. Williams and Thomas Hudspeth, build the SINCOM family of satellites, first launched and deployed in 1961. SINCOM 3 relays television signals from the Tokyo Olympics around the world. Soon, SINCOM is joined in geostationary orbit by Intelsat 1 and other geosync spacecraft. The global communication village comes alive, and the world will never be the same. Hughes Aircraft Company split into smaller companies. The SATCOM division became Hughes Space and Communications Company and is now part of Boeing Defense Space and Security. Today, there are hundreds of satellites from dozens of countries in geostationary orbits. It's high-value real estate in the heavens with Earth imaging, weather, surveillance, and communication satellites all jockeying for their prime spot high above the equator. It's fitting that today we call this ring of spacecraft above the Earth the Clark Belt, envisioned by one man wondering, what if, and looking into a future not filled with war and dread, but promise and opportunity. Space is hardly the final frontier.
What?
Boiling ocean floors, scorching deserts, frozen microclimates, deep, dark caverns. NASA scientists and researchers seek out the most extreme places right here on Earth to learn and observe what we might encounter on other worlds. Hot springs in Yellowstone are among the most inhospitable environments on Earth. Extremely acidic with very high temperatures, like boiling battery acid. NASA was there providing research money to study how organisms respond and adapt to harsh geothermal environments. The last thing researcher Mark Cosible expected to find was life thriving in this hostile cauldron. But there it was. A fungal microbe living the dream in Yellowstone Hot Springs.
Several characteristics made it intriguing. It lives in this harsh environment, but Mark and fellow researchers at Montana State University also found it thrived in lab environments and would produce a high protein content. It was named Fusarium strain flavolapis, and encouraged by MSU advisor Rich Maker, the search was on to find commercial applications that capitalized on these unique properties. In 2012, Mark and Rich started a new company called Sustainable Bioproducts to explore applications using this tough little fungus. The initial research goal was to produce biofuels from the organism. Curious and ever experimental, one day they cooked up the protein product, heated in foil with a little canola oil, tasted it, and realized that food, not fuel, was the promise of this tiny fungus. The company gets a big boost from investment fund execs Thomas Jonas and Matthew Strongen, who are excited enough about the potential of Flavolapis to join the company in 2015. They help raise significant capital that enables product R&D. Even Bill Gates is in.
This company, Nature's Find, is using fungi.
It wasn't until 2018 that the company, now called Nature's Find, focused on efforts creating versatile food products. High in protein and fiber while being low in fat, it was easy to produce, especially compared to meat and dairy. The commercial food ingredient called phi is used to make a vegan breakfast sausage and cream cheese that have more protein, more fiber, and less fat than animal products. NASA has researched ways to support astronauts on long-duration missions, and phi offers great potential for space travel. In 2022, a special growth bioreactor was designed and built with help from BioServe Space Technologies to test how it might work in microgravity. The experiment flew on the International Space Station and demonstrated that phi could be successfully grown in microgravity. Today you can find Nature's Find products at grocery stores across the U.S. It's another example of space science and space technology making life better and tastier here on Earth.
13, we've got one more item for you when you get a chance. We'd like it to stir up your cryo tanks. In addition, I have a shaft and trunnion.
Okay.
For a look at the Comet Bennett if you need it.
Okay. Stand by.
It's interesting to note you might not pay too much attention to something until it breaks.
Okay, we've had a problem here.
No worries if you've got spares or a rocket supply store nearby. But what if you could predict failure before it happened?
Computer, scan the shuttle's structural integrity.
Submicroscopic deformations are present in the nose section and aft thrusters.
Take a complex design, model it, bend it, stretch it, twist it over and over again through software before the design is built. That's the idea behind fracture analysis. Fatigue failures happen when tiny cracks grow large under repeated stress. At NASA, Royce Foreman developed software to analyze and predict crack propagation starting in the 1960s. The software analysis tool that Foreman and team developed at NASA Johnson Space Center proved to be a vital tool in designing new systems. Foreman led development of the software well into the 1990s when NASA's Joachim Beek took over the leadership role and directed NASA's Johnson team in the software's ongoing development. They knew that such a useful tool could benefit other industries as well. NASA opened up the use of the software to the public. Called NASGROW, the tool is essential in a wide variety of applications and industry demand was high. But the software demanded extra support, which NASA couldn't provide. NASA licensed the software to Southwest Research Institute, or SWRI, and SWRI's directive was to turn the system into a commercially available product. Through a Space Act agreement, there is no financial compensation to either side. NASA and SWRI together support and continue to enhance the software. NASA gets unlimited use of the software and gets customization and enhancements that are used in virtually all space programs. In turn, SWRI licenses the software to industry users. Over 1,000 licenses have been issued across hundreds of companies worldwide. as WRI also manages a consortium of 24 major users who help guide the future enhancements to the system. Craig McClum, who leads tech development and manages the consortium, and Joe Cardinal, who leads planning and licensure, have worked together to build the commercial success of the NASCRO system. Today, it's the gold standard tool for fracture and microstress analysis. A great example of how NASA research and industry partnerships work for all of us in little ways we can't even see.
My visor's picking up some torsional stress damage, some microfractures. Hang on a second. What's this?
Tonight, we induct into the Space Technology Hall of Fame, SINCOM, Geostationary Satellite Communication. Nature's Find Liquid Air Fermentation. NASGRO, Fatigue Analysis Software. Since 1988, Space Foundation has proudly honored hundreds of organizations and individuals who have taken technologies originally used for space exploration and applied them to improve life here on Earth. Public safety, healthcare, transportation, education, communications, energy, consumer products. Space technology is a part of everyday life that makes the world a better place for all of us.
Thank you to our friends at Motion Pixel for that great overview of the class of 2023. Well done, guys. Thank you very much. As we begin our formal induction program, I'd like to call forward Space Foundation CEO Tom Zellibor and have NASA Johnson Space Center Director Vanessa Weiss join us again here on the stage to assist with the presentation of our hall plaques. As Tom and Vanessa come to the stage, I'd also like to acknowledge this year's Space Technology Hall of Fame judges who poured over a lot of details from this year's nominees and had some very hard choices to make. If we can put the judges' names up, oh, they're up there. How about the big screen, too? How about that? We're grateful to each and every one of them. And if we have some of those judges here tonight, would you please stand to be acknowledged? Thank you. Prior to this evening's dinner, we did have a private induction ceremony where we recognized the individuals who made these three technologies possible. And at that ceremony, individual medals were presented. And by chance, if you see one of them walking around tonight and with some extra bling, that's a Hall of Famer. So please go over, congratulate them, thank them for what they do. And again, we've got them all over there, so you're gonna meet a number of them very, very shortly. But again, we are grateful to all of you for what you do. But it's now time to honor three outstanding new technologies and the organizations that made them possible. As the video showed you, they include geostationary satellites, SINCOM, Nature's Find, and NASGRO. And with that, let's get busy. In recognition of their innovative efforts, the following organizations are officially inducted into the Space Technology Hall of Fame. Representatives, please come forward as your name is called. Geostationary satellites, SINCOM. Boeing's Defense, Space, and Security, represented by Dr. Michelle Parker, Vice President, Space Mission Systems, Boeing Defense, Space, and Security. Nature's Find, Mr. Thomas Jonas, CEO, and Dr. Rich Maker, co-founder. NASGRO, NASA's Johnson Space Center, Vanessa Weiss, Director, and Mr. Joachim Beek, JSC Fracture Control Lead. They are joined by the Southwest Research Institute, Dr. Craig McClung, Program Director, and Mr. Joseph Cardinal, Program Engineer. Gentlemen, the class of 2023 for the Space Technology Hall of Fame. She gets to go. Before I surrender the stage tonight, I have two things left to do. The first is a challenge. I'm sure there are a number of you who are sitting out there thinking, you know, why isn't my technology up there? Why aren't they in that? And here's the challenge. I want you to tell your story. Tell your story and the difference that you make. We, this community are going back to the moon and doing more than that. We save lives, we protect the planet, we create really cool jobs. We invent and do things that are often truly unimaginable. We give content that helps teachers inspire that next generation of innovator and entrepreneur and explorer. We also have the best visuals of any group of people on the planet. And we do really cool stuff that literally beeps, a lot of it, and literally roars to life from launch pads. We are the global space community, and folks, we have the greatest stories to be told. We just need to be doing more of it. You've all seen the polls. People are enthusiastic about what we're doing, but we all need to do a better job of telling them why. The Space Technology Hall of Fame is a great place to tell your story. So I challenge you that if you've been sitting there and saying, hey, my stuff ought to be in there too, maybe you should. But if you don't tell your story, no one else is going to do it for you. In the coming days, we'll be opening nominations for the class of 2024. Hey, folks, it's our Cooperstown. And like Cooperstown, you get really cool plaques. But you know what else? You get medals. Cooperstown doesn't have medals. We do. So is your name on this medal? I challenged folks last year, and we got a great set of applications this past year. My challenge is that if your technology, if you think your technology belongs there, look out for the nomination process, because I hope so. I hope you're up here on this stage or in future years to celebrate what you do, because it's important, because we're always going to need to be ready to answer that question of why. We at Space Foundation want to hear your story, we want to share your story, and we want to celebrate it. And now the last thing I got to do. You know, Space Foundation just turned 40. We look pretty good for 40. Maybe not as well-rounded as 50 plus, but in its 40 years, Space Foundation's had a number of leaders. And every one of those leaders has had their share of challenges. In fact, the truth is, when the first symposium was held, all of it, exhibits, sessions, activities, all of it was in this room, okay? For any of you who are now really wishing you had bought those Dr. Scholl's sole inserts for your shoes because of all the walking you've done, yeah, it would have been easy to have had it done in one room, but nowadays, we're on two campuses, we're in two exhibit centers, and a whole lot of other things. What we have built at Space Foundation is built upon those, the leadership and the staff of that time in that 40 years. They've all had challenges, but they haven't had the challenges that Tom Zelibor has had. Yeah. When Tom came on board, He literally had to have the conversation about how do we move this organization and move this assembly and make it bigger. He worked with the Broadmoor in order to get an expanded exhibit hall so that we no longer had to live in tents. And for those of you who remember the tents, again, isn't Bartleton Hall a whole lot better? So there was the challenge of moving on to that, but one of the things that Tom always challenged this organization is to elevate, and he's done that. And when that exhibit hall was coming about, we were literally 2 weeks away from opening it. We all know what happened. It was called COVID. We know what COVID is, right? It's a four-letter word with 20% inflation added onto it. It sucked. It was not fun. Our organization, like many of yours, had to make some tough choices, and those hurt. But in the midst of all of that, our organization took on some bigger challenges looking to build that next generation of workforce. So in the midst of all of that, we created our Center for Innovation and Education. That is designed to help us build that next generation of talent, literally from the young person to that person who's looking for a career change. We're doing that. That happened under his leadership. There's been a lot of challenges that he's had. And again, I remember when I first started working for Tom, I sat down and did a media interview with him, and it was with one of the local outlets, and they asked him who he really was. And he looked at the reporter and he said, "I'm an impact guy." It was sort of like being with Clint Eastwood for a moment. I'm an impact guy. Well, he is. And the measure of any good leader is the impact that they have on an organization. We are not the same organization that we were 40 years ago. We are not the same organization that we were last year. In fact, over this past year, we at Space Foundation have more than doubled in size. We are 110 plus strong. And they're all out there, and I love them all. Tom's been that impact guy for us, and we're grateful. And tonight is his last night here at Symposium as our CEO. We're a different organization today because of him, and we're going to be a different organization because of the leadership of Heather Pringle when she comes on. We keep getting better and better and better because there are impact people like Tom Zelibor that come into our orbit, and we're really grateful. We're going to miss him. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to meet an impact guy. His name is Tom Zelibor. Yeah.
I did not pick that walkout song. Yet again, we are closing another amazing and fantastic symposium. And I want to thank all of you for your support. I know there have been a lot of challenges this week, many of them you probably didn't even know about. But sometimes it's stated, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. But speaking of challenges, where's Lieutenant General Shaw? There he is, over on table six. I'm going to pull out my inner Lieutenant General Shaw. You ever seen him give a presentation? It's just incredible. I would love to put a little microbe in his skull when he gives a speech, because I envision there's about 16 little compartments, and each compartment has a bunch of files, and somehow he's able to release those one at a time and give the most logical, impactful speeches ever. And I would love to be able to have that talent. As many of you can attest to, springtime in the Rockies can present some challenges. However, this aspect of the 38th Symposium has been superb. In my six symposiums as CEO, I've seen rain, sleet, snow, hail, heat, cold, gale force winds. Got us a new building, though. And rumor has it, way back in the day, there may have actually been locusts. So last Sunday, we had the Space Foundation's Board of Directors meeting, and at the end of the meeting, I got really weepy. I'm not sure if it was from pure joy that it was my last board meeting, or if it was true emotion. I have to let you know it was the latter. I thought, what the heck? I'm a tough, hard-nosed guy that grew up the son of a Korean War Marine veteran, and I grew up in Chicago. But those who really know me realize that I'm pretty much a softy at heart. I love people, and I love giving 110% to every job I've ever had. So I suddenly realized that in life, we are brought into this world helpless, fat, and crying. My aha moment was, unfortunately, we go out the same. So as I stated in the opening ceremony, this is my last symposium as the CEO of Space Foundation. I used to think retirement was a four-letter word, but I actually am really looking forward to spending more time with my family, but more on that later. There are so many people to thank for all the successes that we have had during my tenure as the CEO. We have grown and flourished even through a pandemic. At a time when many nonprofits went under, we came out stronger. Was it challenging? You bet. But we were able to pivot and become the even better organization that all of you know today. So who are these people that I have to thank? First and foremost are our partners, the Broadmoor. This is a partnership that has stood a test of time. As a matter of fact, 39 years to be exact. I have established a friendship with Jack DeMoli and his team here at the Broadmoor, and I cannot thank them enough for everything they do because we act as one, and we execute the largest space event on this planet. Every organization should strive to be as well organized in execution and otherwise as the Broadmoor. They are simply the best. Next is all of you. If we did not have the great support from the space industry, the military, especially our guardians, the newest service that we have, our international partners, and so many more to make this event the greatest show on Earth, I'm not sure it could be as successful. I know you've heard this before, but by all accounts, we absolutely crushed the number of participants this year. It's so much so, I actually considered going back to Jack and see if I could get another new building out of him. If I did that, I would not be standing here right now, I guarantee it. Next, the Space Foundation Board. Their support and guidance has been invaluable to me over the last 6 years. I was brought in during a challenging time for the Space Foundation in its history, and they gave me all the leeway I needed. I needed to do a lot of things that weren't easy, and we made our great company even better. Names like Jim Ellis, Willie Shelton, Kathy Thornton, and Jeff Grant, all amazing chairs of our boards of directors. They were every CEO's dream. They let me do my job. They gave me and our great organization the tools and resources we needed to succeed, and we did. I think I even surprised them at how successful we've been. Even with an 18-month COVID pause without being able to do a symposium, we flourished, and I called the COVID the COVID coma. Lots of organizations just drew in. We expanded and gave new offerings and found a new way to do business. Second to last, the Space Foundation team. Now, where do I start with this crowd? This is the most amazing group of professionals, and I have watched them change and mature over the last 6 years like I've never seen. When I arrived in 2017, we were 55 strong, and Rich just mentioned we're now 110. It's not those numbers, but it's the impact that we have. Yeah, I'm an impact guy. It's the impact we have, and I knew they were capable. But they had that learn that lesson for themselves. I've always been a big believer in giving people guidance and then letting them do their jobs. My C-suite, team leaders, and employees executed flawlessly. There are many leadership lessons I taught them, and they could probably easily recite most of them, but my big three, which they heard often, were be flexible, and check each other's six. Those are my live-by rules, and they follow them, at least most of the time. I could not be prouder of having the opportunity to be their CEO. So I ask that the staff here bring up the lights a little so you can meet this incredible team, if they could please stand up and their guests. What a group. They're about 80 plus strong in here tonight, so this is the first time. I think they were the ones raising all the racket back there earlier. I'll deal with that tomorrow. And finally, to my wife, Ann. We've made a lot of personal sacrifice during this time, and we made some really tough personal decisions, but they were important for our family. She has never complained. You may not know what I'm referring to, but even after 30 years in the Navy, 8 full deployments of at least 6 months, I officially declare this deployment the longest in my career. Now, what's that mean? We chose not to move down to Colorado Springs because our kids were still in school. So I've been commuting to Colorado Springs for the last 6 years. In case you're wondering, it's 102 miles each way, an hour and 53 minutes long, but who's counting? Unbelievable. All that time I've been living in either a small apartment and then in small hotels, and trust me, they were not the Broadmoor. Anne is not only my partner, but she is truly my best friend. I can't thank you enough, sweetheart, for all your love and support. I couldn't have done it without you by my side. I love you and thank you. So now it's on to the next phase of our lives. I can tell you Anne's already threatened me not to just hang around the house and drive her crazy. She knows me well. So I'll keep up my board work, hobbies, and travel with the family as a priority. I know Space Foundation will only get better under Heather Pringle's leadership, and I look forward to watching from a distance as all that happens. Thank you.
Boss! Boss! Boss, you know I live and work in Washington, D.C., and I'm gonna do something, admit something. I lied. I have one more thing to do.
Just one.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chairman of the Board, Jeff Grant.
Jeff. Thank you.
I am the last thing between you and the rest of the evening. As Tom mentioned, on behalf of the Board of Directors, current and past, luminaries in industry and government, foreign, our young groups, we all loved having Tom leading the Space Foundation for the last 6 years. He's done a tremendous job, and I wanted to step out here and just say as sincere from the heart, thank you very much. I'm gonna mention one other thing. Tom is a graduate of the Naval Academy with what degree? Oceanography. What a way to bookend it. From the ocean to the space and beyond. He's had a stunning career. We so much appreciate the work you've done for us and wish you and Anne the best.
Thank you.
fair seas and a following wind.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.